time to do justice to their presentation and to the questions I'm sure you're going to have this afternoon. So I see my role as not taking up too much time away from the panelists and for you and the question and answer time. So I'll just try and keep things moving along so we can use the time productively. So I'd like to get things moving by asking Minister Monsef to please provide her with her opening remarks.
Together, they put their differences aside, and they focus on a movement that's been passed down to us for generations, a movement that is so noble, because we know that when women and girls and people of different genders are empowered and enabled, society benefits, communities benefit, and in today's globalized reality, when one part of the world is hurting, we are all hurting, and so to be in a room with so many advocates and leaders is a great honor, Mr. Chair. I'd also like to thank our UN Ambassador, Marc-André. Thank you so much for hosting us here today and for all the good work that you do on behalf of Canada here at the United Nations. Could I ask my provincial and territorial counterparts, the ministers who are in the room, who hold really important portfolios when it comes to gender equality, could you rise? If you're a representative of a minister, please do the same and rise so that people know. Celine is here, the Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister of International Development. We have the Minister from Ontario. We have the Minister from Nova Scotia. Do we have Minister Dennis? She's in a session. So I hope you take the opportunity to connect with our colleagues here and get to know them. How many NGO reps in the room? Could you raise your hands? You are the heart of the women's movement, so thank you for your ongoing advocacy every day. How many private sector folks in the room right now? Raise your hands. Other public sector? Okay. Media? All right, so it's just us. Perfect. I'm representing proudly a country that has done great things when it comes to human rights, and the protection and the advocacy of members of vulnerable groups, including those of LGBTQ2 communities. We've taken some steps forward in Canada. I'm here to talk about some of those steps, but I also recognize that we have a significant amount of work to do. There are people here from the Status of Women Canada who are gonna stay in the room and take some notes, because Canada comes to this place also with a great deal of humility. We know that as the country of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, we are doing important work. We know that we have a responsibility on the international stage. And so my colleague's announcement of $650 million for sexual and reproductive health and rights was very well received. And so we're doing what we can, where we can. But we recognize that here at the Commission, in rooms like this, there are stories and there's a lot of wisdom that Canada needs to benefit from. So I thank you for being here. I hope you share your stories with us. The rights that have been extended to lesbian, bisexual, and transgendered women will have to make a difference in the quality of life and future prosperity, and they have. Without question, there's more work to be done to improve access to government services, in particular for transgender women. But we know that in Canada, our track record is strong and strengthening. For example, same-sex partners have full access to federal programs and services, including parental benefits and government pensions. To address the basic rights of transgender and gender non-conforming peoples in Canada, our governments moved legislation to explicitly include gender identity and gender expression in the Canadian Human Rights Act, and to ensure that hate speech on gender equality or gender expression is an offense under our criminal code. Our Prime Minister, an openly and proudly feminist prime minister who reminds us of why it's important to include men and boys in the conversation for gender equality, has appointed a special advisor on LGBTQ issues, will bring a critical lens to the work that our government's doing to support Canadians, but also to show that leadership on the international stage. Our same prime minister has struck a youth advisory council whose perspectives on gender, sexuality, and what it means to be a young person today will continue to bring Canada to the forefront of progressive public policy. I want to pause for a moment and talk about youth. How many of you were here for the UN youth gathering yesterday and the day before? Stand up, stand up. So incredibly proud. This is our future. These are the leaders of today, and I'm so proud. Over 700 young people from 85 different countries gathered for the last few days for what you heard the UN head, UN women head, call a fountain of ideas. And with the declaration that they presented us with, what I was struck by the most was that you explicitly asked that we take into account that gender is not binary. We're not talking about women and men anymore in the fight for gender equality, because in doing so we are leaving out significant and marginalized peoples without whose gifts we will not achieve our full potential. I was so proud to be in that room with you yesterday, and I was fighting back tears because I know that the gender equality movement is in good hands with you. So your work and our work in Canada, these are positive steps, but significant work needs to continue to focus on gender-based violence. We know that LGBTQ people are overall especially vulnerable to violence rooted in misogyny and other gender stereotypes. These threats to their safety also put their economic security at risk. Now, our government is committed to addressing gender-based violence in all its forms, and we'll be presenting our first ever federal strategy to address gender-based violence in the coming weeks. I just want to emphasize, Canada is about to celebrate its 150th birthday, and this is our first ever federal strategy designed to address and prevent gender-based violence, an issue that some would say is as old as time. One of the most critical tools that we have as a government to address the needs of LBT women is the use of gender-based analysis, affectionately known as GBA+. This tool helps to ensure that federal government's decisions about policies, programs, and legislations are made with a full understanding of the impacts on Canadians in all their diversity. In Canada, we've added a plus to recognize that equality also includes ability and exceptionalities, race, income status, immigration, education, regionality, so whether you live in a rural area, a remote area, or an urban area, as well as indigeneity. I'm proud of the work that our government's done, because equality is not only a core value to our country, but we're also determined to walk the talk by empowering all women and people of all genders to succeed as themselves, but also within their families, in their workplaces, in their communities, and in their countries. We also hope to inspire young people, women and girls, and people of different genders along the way, because we know they're watching. In Canada, we know that economic security and prosperity of LBT women is not only a right, but it's that this security in turn plays an important role in contributing to the overall prosperity of our country. I was mentioning to the panel before, my ancestral land is Afghanistan. And Afghanistan, for all its resilience and for all the gifts that it continues to contribute to the world, is an important reminder of what happens when we leave half of the population out of any conversation. What happens when we leave half of the population out of the economy and out of society? We rob ourselves of the resilience and the gifts that they bring, And so we won't be as able to meet the challenges of this new order that we all belong to. Collaborating with Canada's friends and partners, we'll be sharing the same messages and hoping to learn from you. So I know that we're on a path forward. I know that because of what I saw yesterday in that room full of young people, and because of what I've seen so far as CSW 61, but we're still working to better understand the unique challenges facing members of the LGBTQ community, which is why I look forward to the conversation today, to the gifts and perspectives that our panel brings, and hopefully you'll take the opportunity to not just get to know each other during your stay here, but to come up to us and to share our stories with you so that we can take them back to our communities in Canada. So thank you again for your incredible work. We have colleagues like Mark Saray who are reminders of why it's important to include men and boys in this conversation, connect with them, and have an inspiring and informative time here.
In such a wonderful fashion, and for inspiring us to feed back and give you more ideas to improve what you're doing, which is excellent to hear what's happening in Canada and inspiration for all of us. I'd like to acknowledge the ambassador too. I'm sorry I didn't acknowledge you earlier, sir. Thank you for hosting this event as well. I will shortly introduce the panelists, but I just wanted to quickly, as I've got the ability to do so, take the opportunity to say on behalf of the ILO as well, that we see the issue of diverse and inclusive workplaces as primarily an issue of social justice, equality, and rights, human rights. And we will not achieve the sustainable development goals unless we end discrimination and address discrimination in the world of work, which is of course the theme of this year's CSW. ILO is committed to promote diverse and inclusive workplaces for everyone. Women and men, disabled, non-disabled, regardless of color or creed, or where LGBT workers are comfortable with being who they are without fear of stigma, discrimination, harassment, or as mentioned by the Minister, violence. ILO has conducted research looking at good practices and at the discrimination against LGBT workers in many countries, in all regions, including in Argentina. And a brochure at the back of the room will describe a summary of the work we've done and the issues that have come out, so I won't spend any time discussing that. It will describe the first phase of this work. And there are a couple of the actual country reports, and of course we can always provide you with those. Our research has found that many LGBT workers in all countries targeted, and that includes, as I said, Argentina, Costa Rica, France, Hungary, Indonesia, Montenegro, South Africa, and Thailand, conceal their sexual orientation in the workplace, experiencing increased stress and deteriorating productivity. Legislation protecting the rights of LGBT workers is often absent or poorly applied. LGBT workers are particularly vulnerable to discriminatory treatment and social protection, so it's good to hear the Minister saying that that kind of protection is being afforded in Canada. Finally, the research shows that persons who do not conform to narrow stereotypes of being masculine or feminine, behaviour or in appearance, often suffer discrimination and sometimes worse on the basis of their perceived sexual orientation. This is the research that we found in these countries. So I hope that some of these issues, as well as how employers and workers' organisations in the workplace can play a role to address these issues today. I'd just like to say, before I introduce the panellists, that the remarks of the panel will be being recorded and they will be available on the ARC website. So it'll only be the front of the stage that will be recorded. So I'd like to introduce the panelists in block. My apologies in advance to them if I don't include every part of their resumes. I had to be a little bit selective given the time. And of course the full bios are at the back of the room for you to collect, and they will be on the website for you to look at. So, I'd like to introduce, of course, the Ambassador, Martin Garcia Moritán, the permanent representative of Argentina to the UN in New York. He was appointed the permanent representative in February 2016, and before that he had a long career in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, dating right back to 2012 and 13, being a special representative of Territorialism Affairs in 2011, General Commissioner for the Argentine Pavilion at the World Expo in Shanghai, China, which would have been an amazing role to play. And he previously served as Argentina's permanent mission to the United Nations in New York between 1995 and 1998, and again from 2003 to 2009. So he's a seasoned ambassador for here in New York. Our next panelist is Jael. Derry Garcia Castillo Salazar. She's a military officer and activist and proud lesbian mother and partner. She's the co-founder or the current president of Our Circle, a voluntary organization dedicated to the active inclusion of the LGBT community in Belize. And that organization creates events that bring together the community in Belize, providing safe spaces to educate, empower, and build a community. So that's a very brief introduction to Jael. Wang Xulian, she's an LGBTI activist and common language and Chinese Lala Alliance. She hails from the Canadian West Coast and has been dedicated to China's LGBTI movement for the past 8 years through service at Common Language, Chinese LGBTI rights advocacy organization, and as I said, Chinese Lala Alliance, a global network of Chinese speaking LBT communities. And then finally, Chloe Schwenk, Director of Violence, Rights and Inclusion, International Center for Research on Women. She's a human rights and social inclusion scholar, international development practitioner, and recently joined the International Center for Research on Women as the Director of Violence, Rights and Inclusion. Very topical issues as we discuss this today. She served as Vice President of Global Programs at Freedom House in Washington, D.C., previously, where she supervised programs and business development. It'll be good to hear your perspective, seeing as we don't have anyone from business here today. So that's the panel. I'd like to first call on Ambassador to give his remarks, and then we'll move through the panelists and then have the question and answers. Thank you very much.
Thank you and good afternoon, and thank you very much for being here. First of all, I would like to express my appreciation to the Government of Canada for being with us today, and particularly to my friend Margaret Bachar, the permanent representative of Canada to the UN. Always it's great to be here. Don't touch it again. Well, this commitment of Canada hosting this event is a true example of their continuous commitment to advance the human rights of LGBT women, exploring ways to overcome obstacles for the empowerment of all women. For Argentina, as co-chair of the LGBT core group in New York, it is an honor to be able to co-sponsor this event and to present our perspective and experience in relation with economic empowerment of LGBT women. I would like to start highlighting the challenge that means developing and implementing policies in a field quite unexplored and where there is a general lack of best practices and good experiences to share among governments. Nonetheless, this challenge is also a great opportunity to be creative and to work closely with civil society to identify gaps, problems, and possible way forward. As a government, the actions aimed at the economic empowerment of LGBT women have to be designed taking into two different realities. First, It is common for LBT workers to face discrimination at work on the basis of their sexual orientation and or gender identity. Moreover, LGBTI persons frequently experience discrimination and harassment at school, which hampers their future employment prospects. Therefore, it is crucial that the government adopts and implements wide-ranging measures to address violence and discrimination against LGBTI people in the educational system. We need to work hard to grant them the right to a quality education and to reduce the disturbing level of dropout of schools among LGBTI youth. In fact, it is the responsibility of the state to ensure the access and permanence of LGBTI people in the educational system, implementing strategies for the eradication of discrimination and violence. It is imperative to include and discuss age-appropriate concepts related to sexual diversity and gender perspective in the pedagogical programs at all educational levels. Second, the government should design strategies to ensure that LGBTI people of all ages have access to decent work. Therefore, we have to create quality income opportunities, integrating actions that promote training, entrepreneurship, and eradication of discrimination in the workplace. While working with the private sector, governments should explore creative ways to increase job opportunities in the public sector with a more diverse participation. In our case, despite the controversial nature of quotas, some local governments, like the province of Buenos Aires, have developed legislation seeking to grant a percentage of all new jobs are for trans people. Those percentages go from 1 to 5%, depending on the jurisdiction. They tend to solve an urgent problem of access to work of trans people and equal opportunities in a society where until recently they were mostly rejected from the formal economy. In parallel, the national ministries of labor and education have signed agreements with civil society organizations and private sector to develop workshops and training opportunities for trans people. Such experiences have been taking place in different cities around the country, Bahía Blanca, Buenos Aires, Mar del Plata, Rosario, Córdoba. They are the most important and large urban areas. We are still exploring different alternatives to empower economically LGBT women, and in particular trans women who were historically in a more vulnerable situation. In order to achieve this, we consider that it's crucial to have full commitment and leadership in the fight against homophobia and transphobia. The role of high-level officials in that sense is irreplaceable. There is no doubt that there has been progress in recognizing the human rights, including labor rights of LGBTI persons. A solid framework has obvious benefits, but we need to be more vocal on what we really mean, leaving no one behind. And there is nothing more concrete to show than real policies reaching out those who have been usually forgotten. Thank you.
Email and they were telling me that I was supposed to be on this panel discussion. And the first thing I actually thought was, what am I going to sit here and talk about? I prepared probably about 5 speeches that at the end of reading them, I'm like, this isn't me. So I decided I'm going to come, no paper, nothing. And I'm just going to tell you guys about the reality that I face as a lesbian woman in the Caribbean. as a military officer in Belize particularly, and as a mother, a lesbian mother, there's a lot in Belize, of course, that since 1978, when we started our women's movement in Belize, there's been a lot of advancement in regards to women's rights and where we are at this point. We've actually gained grounds in gender policy. We've gained grounds in common law union. We've gained grounds in actually having a say or having a share if there is supposed to be a divorce or what the woman would be entitled to in the relationship if it were to fall apart. However, in that, in all those policies that I mentioned, there's nothing in there for me, because my relationship itself is not considered a marriage. My relationship is not considered common law. My relationship is not even considered. Numerous times it's been described as a rage of hormones. And this is for someone who is in a serious relationship for going on 7 years. My partner and I have decided that we're going to have a child. He's 2 today. Today's his birthday. he's 2 years old today, and we're still not considered to be to have a relationship. My name is Castillo Salazar because we did a deep poll in order for us to join our names together. And we're still just considered as roommates who live in the same house. And we're both in the military. We're both serving our country. And within all these advancements, there is nothing in there for us. So for me, I'm actually a captain in the regular force. It's my 24/7 job. That's what I do. I give back to my country. And if something was supposed to happen to me tomorrow, the law, my family, everyone has the right to take my son away from my partner, because technically she's not considered his biological mother. If she is to have that, I'm supposed to give up guardianship of him. So it's either or either. And for us serving the military, we both, after a certain period, we would be liable to getting our pension, our government pension, and literally he's not considered a beneficiary of hers. And I think about that because in every day when I'm considered a troublemaker, I love that name, but every day when I have something to say in regards to what's happening with my life, I actually got a feedback last week when I attended a discussion by one of our fellow organizations, PETAL. I used my rank to actually take the females that work with me to this session. And I was asked by my superior, why do you guys need to have a women's month? Don't you already have all the rights that you need? And I told him, I said, the interesting thing about this talk is that this is being co-sponsored by an LB organization, a lesbian bisexual organization. And to be honest, that was the first time that LGBT, although they're only lesbian and bi, organization has actually publicly addressed the infraction that we face. And to an extent, I told him, while I might be the only lesbian that's here, I'm the only one who's publicly saying that I'm a lesbian. There are others who are there working, who are serving their country, and they're not as open as I am to say that they are lesbian. Or there are some guys who are not open to say that I do not feel I'm in the right body, that I feel that I'm transgender. There are some guys who are bisexual, some women who are bisexual. And because of the policies that are in place, we don't feel protected. Every day it's a challenge. Like I say, it's a challenge for me. And I look at it, and at something that struck me was the fact that they said men and boys should be included. I remember when my partner and I decided we wanted to have a child, we prayed to the universe for a boy. And my mom's like, why do you want a boy? Society will say you're going to turn the boy gay. I told my mom, that's my opportunity to actually turn a boy into a man. Because if I have a woman, if I have a female, she'll probably go through what I go through. But if I have a son and he sees what a woman goes through, he will grow up to appreciate women. And he'll be one to step up and say something because his mothers are going through it. So I personally believe that with the advancement, especially in Canada and across the world, not only in Belize, but there are a lot of other Caribbean countries who go through, who have pretty much the same policies that we face in Belize. Yes, we've made advancement with Section 53. However, there's still a lot more that needs to be covered. And I think with addressing LBT issues within Belize and within the Caribbean, it's still taboo. And because it's still taboo, we find that while we're included in these policies, we're outrightly being excluded because it's not being stated. There is no law in Belize that has the word sexual orientation in it. They have been addressing to have sexual identity being placed in regards to it, but that is only to counter us for Marriage Act so that we don't challenge the Marriage Act. So within Belize and other Caribbean countries, there's a lot of work that has been done. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. And in the end, it points back to us actually having a voice, to us actually being invited to the tables in order for us to discuss what we face or our issues that we face. And like I said, I wanted to bring a lot of statistics and things, but I thought that it was important to bring the reality of what we face. We work, we put in our pound within our country, we do what we're supposed to do. And yet in the end, we are still not stable families because we're not considered families. So I think discussing the LBT, I'm going to say the LGBTQI persons within policies, it's very important, not only economically, but socially, because we're here, we need to be included. And it's not only us being affected, it's our children. So thank you very much for that.
With the amazing stories. So I'm going to pick up on what both Minister Montsev and the Ambassador has said about LBTI people having access to the workplace and some of the challenges that they face in the changing world of work. I will be talking about the first ever transgender employment discrimination case that my organization, Common Language, litigated over the past year in China, and how this is significant in propelling China's anti-discrimination legislation. So the plaintiff of this case, Mr. C, he is a community organizer, LBTI community organizer, trans man in a southwestern province in China. So last year he got a job as a health consultant in a very popular medical chain. And after a week he was terminated from this job. And HR cited that he dressed like a lesbian and did not project a healthy image, therefore was unfit to be a health consultant in the center. And because his identity card still said female, even though he identified, dressed as a man and lived as a man, but in China you'd have to go through the full set of sexual reassignment surgery to have the gender change on your ID card. So this litigation, this case, was picked up by public interest lawyers pro bono a couple of months after the incident happened. Because in the initial few months, even though Mr. C reached out to a couple of lawyers, they said because there might be insufficient evidence for litigation, so it was not picked up. So first, this case went to the local labor arbitration committee, and it was inconclusive in the committee, so Mr. C then took it to court. And in the hearing, we introduced an expert testimony from a professor who is the leading expert on anti-discrimination legislation in China. And she's on the committee to draft the actual law that is being drafted right now. And this is the first time that a witness testimony has been used in either a employment discrimination case or a LGBTI rights case. And in a historical ruling last December, the judge actually ruled that it was unlawful termination and awarded Mr. C with back pay. But the judge did not acknowledge explicit discrimination in this case. So of course, even though we won, we were still not satisfied, and Mr. C is taking the case to another civil court on the grounds of recognition of discrimination. So this is happening next month, so which is really, really exciting. So what is the importance of this? Concrete impact litigation examples like this does not only garner media attention, even though Mr. C's face was all over New York Times, the Washington Post, a bunch of Chinese media, both local and domestic, but this also facilitates stakeholder buy-in from lawmakers and legal experts, and especially legal experts who are on drafting committees of these upcoming laws. You know, national level proposed legislation takes anywhere from years to decades to, you know, maybe never getting passed in China. The anti-domestic violence law took well over a decade. So concrete cases like this and in our rulings like these are really legally relevant and influential, and especially when it's, you know, coordinated within a broader advocacy effort on the issue. So our advocacy strategy has been to pair evidence-based research with strong case examples to cultivate allies within the legal community who are commissioned to draft these laws. So over the last couple of years, we have been really active in engaging with policy development in this way. So the current draft of the anti-discrimination in employment law in China is Shouji inclusive. So it includes language on sexual orientation, gender identity, which is great. But there definitely still are a lot of challenges and maybe years to come before this can be shepherded past the National People's Congress, the Standing Political Bureau, and, you know. So, but in the meantime, what we are doing is to continue to engage in this way, as well as empowering LGBTI communities to be aware of their legal rights and to augment legal justice so that more cases like this can be brought forth to influence policy development, as well as just the capacity to address rights violations when they happen. So this is a combination of strategy that we're using. And I'm going to stop here, and I would love to field questions later on this, and definitely look forward to talking about this more.
Well, thank you all for being here. This is fairly important to see so many faces in the room. I want to start off just by an observation, and that is that I am here. And that's an important statement for a transgender woman to make when you're talking about empowerment. Because around the world, we are not here. In fact, our biggest single problem is that legally, we don't exist in so many countries. We have no identity documents. We're not recognized. When you have no identity documents, you don't get a job. You don't get a place to rent. You can't travel. You can't participate in the economy. You do not exist. So when you're trying to have a conversation about empowerment, you're not even there. You're not even there. So that's the starting point. That's where we begin. We have a lot to talk about once we get past that stage. And once we get past that stage, it's still not a pretty picture for us. We have a whole history of having been discriminated against, misunderstood, humiliated, stigmatized, all sorts of ways of taking down our identity, denying our authenticity. Why is it so hard to trust somebody's declaration that they are who they are? How can we even begin any other conversation when we can't get that far? Okay, well, some of us do get that far. Some of us don't have legal presence, but we're still outspoken. And those of us who take that step have to deal with another major problem that anybody who's worked in human rights knows, and that is the risk of insecurity, safety. We really can't have any human rights conversation when we can't get to a place of safety and security. All the rest is just theory. Acquiring that safe space is a major hurdle in and of itself. And we're not even beginning to talk about empowerment yet. Just safety. Being present and being safe. Those are pretty obvious starting points, but very few countries will afford us even that. We're just not there. We have a lot of lived reality factors that get in the way too. Not most, but a significant proportion of us live in really awful stages of poverty, of joblessness, of inability to access even basic public services, if you have a sore throat or just want to see a doctor for any reason whatsoever, I'm not talking about transitioning, I'm not talking about gender transition work, I'm talking about a sore throat. You can't go to a doctor in most parts of the world without getting so much abuse and humiliation. In some places, as you know, we're criminalized. Our existence is criminalized. How do we make ourselves present? How do we pursue empowerment when we have a sore throat? But even when we can't access housing or jobs or education or any of the other services that people simply take for granted and ought to take for granted. That's really what governments are supposed to do. My organization, the International Center for Research on Women, we're a research group. We do advocacy, but we work with statistics, we work with numbers. And that's hard for the trans community because there's almost no data. Why? Well, we don't exist to start with, remember that? So it's really hard, there are no categories to record our lived realities. Even in the health field where unfortunately, trans women have the highest incidence rates of HIV/AIDS. Until really just the last 3 years, we have been grouped as men who have sex with men. I'm not a man, guys. Only recently, still not all around, do we get classified under what we are. So how do we get data? How do we do the analytical work that puts us into the policy discussions when, again, we're not there? Again, we don't have people funding the essential baseline research that allows us to be there in a policy discussion. That's our struggle right now, is to get there in so many different ways so that when we sit in a room like this, we can say, well, you've all read the report. We have very little data. Most of it's anecdotal. The only exception to that is the US transgender survey that was done in the United States, which is my country, in 2015, almost 28,000 people participated in that survey. So it's a robust survey, a really substantial survey, and it sets the standard for what we could do around the world if somebody would fund it. The findings of that are pretty dire. Of those 28,000 people, 68% of them have no authentic gender documentation. These are Americans, no documentation whatsoever. So you can imagine what they're up against trying to get anything done at all. 47% of them have faced sexual assault in their lifetimes, and 10% in the last year alone. Just think about what that means as well. 29%, nearly a third, live in poverty in the United States. 15% are unemployed. That's three times the American standard average right now. So, you know, trying to get that job when you don't have the right documents, when you might look a little different, we're dealing with some deeply ingrained prejudices here that are so hard to overcome. And 30% of trans people are homeless or have experienced homelessness, 1 in 10 just in the last year. Again, this goes back to not being able to access any legal opportunities to rent, to be there, to have jobs, etc. This is what we're up against. I wish I had good news to share. There's a few of us that are making our voices heard. We're doing that more and more. Even that's hard to do. We have such strong allies in the lesbian and gay and bisexual community. They have to continue speaking with us, but they also have to give us room to speak for ourselves. And that's not happening enough. We're pushing them about that. They're getting used to it. We have to move there. We have to get there. And this is where we're at right now. My appeal to most people right now is to help us map out, because I would say this as an analyst, map out what these lived realities look like. Help us have the conversation in a more robust, comprehensive way. Help us make our case so that we're not just talking anecdotes. As powerful as those can be, we need the data. Thank you.